Hi, my name is Jihoon Jung. This is fifth lecture of Deep Learning on Healthcare. In this lecture, I will continue explaining case study of healthcare deep learning startup Lunit. So that if you didn't heard of previous lecture, I recommend take previous one. To accomplish the goal of DIB, data-driven imaging biomarker, we've completed POC study, proof of concept study at 2016 for detecting tuberculosis from chest X-ray images. We've got quite good result on it, and that becomes the first prototype of DIB applications. But there were some limitations. Since the first generation of DIB was developed only using data without human supervision, there were frequent unwanted bias. Sometimes undesired imaging features were learned from the training data. Here are typical examples. First, device vendors was correlated to diagnosis result. For example, sometimes images from GE devices and Philips device had different result, even if the images got same result by radiologist. This is because the image quality and the image setting is quite different. Another example is that iatrogenic markers such as metal marker lead to wrong diagnosis. In this example here, small metal marker in mammogram makes DIB bias. So we try to solve this problem. We adopted semi-supervision, semi-supervised learning, or weekly supervised learning for this problem. Fully supervised learning is actually very hard to accomplish, since each labeling for the supervision is very expensive, especially for the medicine. Therefore, we tried partial human guidance to avoid learning unwanted features, and it works quite well. Even though 1/3 or 1/4 of the great annotated training samples can be used unannotated, just classification result samples together, and it removed unwanted biases quite efficiently. Next step was to collaborate with strong training and validation partners. Lunit have built great hospital partners in Korea and United States. This kind of hospital consortium is the key for preparing high-quality training data with associated follow-up information. One of the greatest strategies was to divide training and validation partners. In Seoul, many cost-effective large-scale training data comes from very big hospitals with over 10 million outpatients per year. Lunit made a great research contract with these big hospitals with the support of research grant from Korean R&D programs, and they've got cleared IRB reviews and de-identified medical images. Co-working with United States, US hospitals were more sought. It is not easy to get large training data from US hospitals, so that Lunit make a program called Validation Partners. For multi-institutional studies, validation partners can use Lunit's DIB solutions to test the accuracy and effectiveness. This is much easier job to do. In United States, UC San Francisco, UPMC, University of Pittsburgh Medical Center, and MD Anderson Cancer Center worked with us, and the partners will be increasing in the future. Here are some of the results. DIB for chest X-ray is now available to anyone using Lunit Insight Cloud service. We've got quite good results comparing with non-radiology physicians, both certified radiologists and thoracic radiologists. The solution had better result than any of them, and also got better result if they used the solution. These results were validated multi-institutional studies too. This is the mammography reader study result. It also had great result. It exceeds the radiologist performance in quite large margin. In pathology, it also works very well. The model and the processes are a little bit different from radiology images. There are so many variations of the specimens, staining, and the protocols of multiple institutions. Therefore, more model-based approaches with some heuristics-based decision-making or traditional machine learning algorithms were combined to get the good result. Understanding these processes in detail exceeds the scope of this lecture. So for the people who is interested, I recommend reading A Unified Framework for Tumor Proliferation Score Prediction in Breast Histopathology, paper by Lunit researchers in 2017 in this archive link. And the next step for the pathology was to make DIB into predictive biomarker. We've got published two papers in 2019 American Association for Cancer Research, AACR, using Luniscope brand for pathology DIB solution with Samsung Medical Center in Korea. Based on the DIB, we've got adopted indicator called RS, recurrence score. It considers ratio of cancer epithelium, cancer stroma, normal necrosis and PET in a whole slide images and take into account for intramural tumor infiltrating lymphocyte TIL and the stromal lymphocyte TIL density. And it correlates with disease-free survival DFS in the patient without adjuvant chemotherapy. Here is a little demonstrations. We call it AI-powered precision pathology, Luniscope. It provides AI-powered identification, classification, and quantification of major histopathological feature. If I if I click case here, it fetches and visualizes data with great histology panel here. We can zoom in and out the slide and click the like this. Cancer, epithelium, stroma, and lymphocyte cells in different colors. Tumor area and tumor stromal epithelium ratio are automatically calculated and shows various lymphocytes too. Using these features and indicator recurrence score RS, we've got very impressive result. This is the diagram showing difference of prognosis with different RS score. As you can see, disease-free survival and overall survival were much higher in low recurrence score. It means that RS score can become a good prognostic biomarker in patients without adjuvant chemotherapy. Then, how about for the chemotherapy patient? Here are comparisons between high and low RS score patient. As you can see, patient with high RS score patient group high RS score had much better responsive to adjuvant chemotherapy than low RS score group. Even though adjuvant chemotherapy were effective for both groups, this is very important first step that DIB in pathology can be helpful to predict the disease prognosis and decide the treatment options. So what will be the next? We think radiologic DIB and pathologic DIB should be analyzed together to decide the treatment decisions. We call it precision imaging. To accomplish this goal, more detailed study of disease models and validation processes are needed. We think role of the DIB will be crucial in every stages of the lung and breast cancers. It will be helpful to screen breast and lung cancer much better than current processes in simple X-ray, CT, and MRI to pathology. It can be applied to more detailed imaging modalities, standard HE and stain, immunohistopathology, and genomics together. It will be called DIB for radiogenomics or imaging genomics. And it can be also be useful to know the prognosis of these two cancers. To proceed to these ambitious goals, Lunit recently appointed a new CEO, Brandon So. This company co-founded by engineers and very successfully implemented a great product. But the course of the growing this company is now more in the medical science path. Brandon is a medical doctor and master of the public health. He is also a family medicine doctor, but he understands the technology very well and proved his insight after joining Lunit as chief medical officer in 2016. He suggested current new vision of Lunit, and we decided promoted him into new CEO with the support by previous CEO Anthony Peck. This is very smooth and great transition. Okay, now I will sum up this case. What are lessons learned? You need to meet with appropriate domain expert and find out real problems that deep learning really can have. Data is really important, not only the quantity of the data, but also the quality of the data. They should be considered together. Collaboration with physicians and hospitals are indispensable. Create strong partner networks. In Lunit's case, there were two different partner networks, training and validation partners. When company reached the point of the big change, leadership change also need to follow. If you provide the evidence and feasibility, there are many physicians who are willing to help you. You are not alone. Okay, this is the end of the case study. I think next lecture will be the last lecture on this series of deep learning on healthcare lectures. I will briefly explain about the regulations of the deep learning applications on healthcare. See you next lecture.